Chairperson Professor Kamina, distinguished Dean of the Faculty of Law, Kotlawala Defense University, respected faculty colleagues, and my dear students. So it's Ayubhavan from me. Vanakkam, good afternoon. It's wonderful standing before all of you and talking to each one of you on a specific problem which faces the legal profession currently. I do not know how many of you are aware of this present challenge. What do you call it as? Multidisciplinary practice. Is there anyone who has read something about this problem which is facing the legal profession, where there is a lot of deliberation going on, especially in the United States? Lawyers are crying about it. Is there anyone who has read some article about multidisciplinary practices? It's new, because I think you are in a very secluded environment in Sri Lanka that you don't need to worry about it as of now, but then the time is not very far away that even you are going to cry about this new challenge which is facing the legal profession, what is called as the multidisciplinary practice. So in the next 15 minutes, I'm sorry, I think I have exhausted 1 minute, so the next 14 minutes, I'm going to talk about what is this multidisciplinary practice is all about and why suddenly there is a boom of multidisciplinary practice, what critics have to say about it, and I am also going to talk about the big four, different countries' position about multidisciplinary practices, what are the challenges these MDPs is posing the legal profession, and what are the opportunities for young people like you. So with that, I would conclude my presentation on this topic. So my topic for the day is multidisciplinary practices, challenges and opportunities for the legal profession. Now, what is this new thing called multidisciplinary practice? As the name sounds, it's a practice involving multiple disciplines. And what is the In the context of legal profession, legal practice is something which is traditionally practiced by lawyers alone, isn't it? Lawyers go for legal practice. But suddenly, there is a challenge to the legal profession where people other than lawyers, for convenience sake, I'll call us non-lawyers, non-lawyers have started practicing law. How is that possible? How is it possible for non-lawyers to practice law, and why do they need to practice law? This is the next question. So the first thing is, I want all of you to be on a common platform, common agreement with respect to the name multidisciplinary practice, or what in abbreviation called as MDP. MDP is a practice by non-lawyer. And why MDP? Why MDP? Why a non-lawyer should start practicing? Why a non-lawyer should advise clients? Why a non-lawyer should guide people on legal issues? That's because of the change the contemporary society is witnessing today. You will find change everywhere, isn't it? For example, the way we bank has changed drastically with the advent of Android and the apps. Now we don't need to go to bank, we do banking just at our fingertips. Sitting at the airport, I was just transacting, I was transferring funds from this account to that account, which few years back, few decades back, I would have never dreamt. I would have spent half a day standing in the bank in a queue to do this work, which I did in a fraction of seconds. So technology. Technology is one big reason why non-lawyers had to come into the legal practice. Not only technology, there are a lot of other reasons. This MDP is something which is practiced by, as I told you, non-lawyers. And who are these non-lawyers who started practicing law is, number one, the auditors, chartered accountants. right? In Sri Lanka, they are called as auditors. Chartered accountants are there. Yes. Chartered accountants, in fact, any business entity, any individual, when there is some financial issues, they go to the chartered accountant first. And now chartered accountants have started encroaching the field of law, especially in the name of tax consulting. They do most of the legal work related to a tax dispute. Economists. What economist has to do with law? Now with the advent of the competition law regime, globally, in the name of promoting free trade, you will find a lot of economists playing a major role. The competition commissions are being judged by economists, are headed by economists. And you have every law firm now having a lot of economics to advise on competitions, mergers, acquisitions, and a lot of other corporate issues. Financial consultants on mergers, acquisitions, stockholding, IPO, all these things. So you find similarly technology issues on cyber security issues, cyber stalking, cyber crime. Now you need, a lawyer cannot independently handle these cyber issues. You need someone who can decode all those things scientifically and tell you. Even if you are a lawyer, you need some technical guidance and assistance on telling you how to crack this, how to find out who is doing what. Because what is happening in the cyberspace is something what lawyers can't comprehend, because we are not generally from the sciences background. We do not understand those terminologies and how things happen the way it's happening in the cyberspace. That is again becoming another planet where every transaction is happening, and it is that space which is too difficult for any authority to regulate. So that is one reason why a lot of these guys have started entering the legal profession in the form of advising the clients. And the why this multidisciplinary practice? Again, from the client's point of view, clients say that we need MDPs, we are very happy with MDPs. That's because it's a one-stop solution. We go to one place, there is a chartered accountant, there is an economist sitting there is an engineer sitting there is an architect sitting there is a lawyer sitting there. We get advice instantly from that particular place. So that is the advantage for the clients. From the consumer's point of view, they feel that nowadays lawyers are becoming incompetent to handle these kind of complex techno-science issues, for example. So therefore, they feel that it's better that we go to a law firm or a firm where they advise, and these firms hire different professionals. Now, when I talk about firms, I need to talk about the big four. So after this session, please check in your mobile phone, Google for this word called big four. Have you ever heard this expression called big four? Please Google for big four. Big four refers to four accounting firms. In terms of size, I'm just ranking them. Number one big four is Deloitte. Have you ever heard this name, Deloitte? Number two is PricewaterhouseCoopers, PwC. You have heard this name? Number three, Ernst & Young, EY, and number four is KPMG, right? Is this name sounds familiar to all of you? I think then you are all very safe. If you have not heard these names, which means you are all in a very safe zone. But then, awake, right? These four are basically accounting firms, which were originally Big Eight, then they become Big Six. Until few years back, they were Big Five, and now it is Big Four, these four companies presently. Just do some small research. A simple Google search will be sufficient to tell you about these four companies, how big these companies are. They are global giants, these four companies. And in fact, these four companies, auditing companies, do almost 99% of companies' audits in the world. You can understand their control over the corporate houses. They do 99%, which means only 1% of the companies here and there are getting audited by somebody else. The global share, 99% of the companies are audited by these companies. I'm interestingly, and all these four are present in Sri Lanka as well. I'm surprised that how come that you young people are not aware of it. Except for Deloitte. Deloitte is not present in Sri Lanka in the name of Deloitte. Deloitte is still present. That is how they enter a country. They enter a country through some Indian, through some names of that particular national. Now in India, in Sri Lanka, Deloitte is known as SJMS. But all the other three companies have come already with their name. You have PwC there. You have Ernst & Young in Sri Lanka, you have KPMG in Sri Lanka. And they have grown to such extent that now no government in any country in the world don't do anything including lawmaking without consulting these four companies. Such is the way that they have encroached the space which was originally with us, with legal professionals. Now, what is the big challenge? What is the big challenge? The biggest challenge is you cannot compete with them. They are such powerful organizations, they are so powerful that tomorrow you cannot have an independent legal practice. These firms will take over this entire space which is being occupied by the national legal fraternity. This is what we have been seeing. For example, in India, I can talk about India and especially what is happening in the law schools. Now, none of our students would want to go and practice in the court. None of our students, especially in those institutions where they need to pay high, where the fees are more, they don't want to spend 5-6 years working under a senior lawyer and doing things like this. Taking advantage of this citizen, all these four companies, they come to the campus, pay young law students such amount of money you cannot imagine. For example, I have an example at home. My eldest son just completed his law 2 months back. He graduated, and I always wanted him to go and practice in the Supreme Court. But then he was picked up by one of these companies. And the kind of salary and the perks that they are offering him, unbelievable. What I could earn after 20 years of experience, he started earning from the very first month. Even his degree, he has not got his degree, but he has started earning such huge sum of money. And now young people are attracted towards us. And why this is a threat? Today I might be happy as a father that my son has got a good job with a huge package, that he has started leading a luxurious life when he is just 21 years. I can be happy as a father, but as a legal professional, I am not happy at all. I am worried that if not this opportunity, my son would have become one of the finest lawyers of the country. Now this country is losing him. Now he is going to work as a slave for these firms, advising corporate entities, sitting in an air-conditioned room, and just he is going to finish his life with that. But I wanted him to be a great lawyer, standing up in the Supreme Court, fighting for the liberty and dignity and life of the common man, which is not going to happen. And this is the way these big four have ruined the legal profession in all the other countries. Now they have started moving towards the developing nations. India they have conquered. I think the next target might be Sri Lanka. So this is something which I thought I should discuss with all of you. At least you guys should start thinking about it. Do some research on how this kind of multidisciplinary practices, especially in the context of legal profession, is going to affect our fraternity, our justice delivery system in any country, is the cause of concern. So this is what I thought I will share with all of you. Thank you so much to the Dean for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share a very important problem which is posing a challenge to the legal fraternity in Sri Lanka, in India, in all the other neighborhood countries. Thank you so much. Thank you.